The results we've seen today come from the phase 3 trial, and they're very exciting because overall we had about 70% protection, so similar to flu vaccines in a good year.
We're very pleased with this result because it means that we can go forward and apply for regulatory approval and get the vaccine out there and widely used.
When we looked into the data, intriguingly, in one of our dosing regimes, the protection was around 90%, where we used a half dose for the first dose and a full dose for the second dose. But that means that because we can use a half dose and get higher protection, we have more doses available to vaccinate people, and we'd be able to cover more of the population sooner.
We vaccinated large numbers of people, and half of them had the Chadox 1 and COVID-19 vaccine, half of them had a different vaccine. Then over time, some of them have become symptomatic.
We compare the number of people that get disease in the vaccinated cohort to the control cohort, and that gives us an efficacy readout.
Every time a participant comes to the clinic, so whether that's when they come for a vaccination or a follow-up visit, we take a blood sample from them and we analyse that to look at their immune responses. And then we're also following up the volunteers to see how well those immune responses last, which tells us how long the protection induced by the vaccine might last as well.
There's a huge mountain of data that comes from a trial of this size with 23,000 people. There's around about 500,000 pages of data that we've collected, all of which have to be checked very carefully before we could get to this point today.
And then the whole package of information on safety, immune responses, and the efficacy of the vaccine will go forward to regulators in many different places applying for licensure to use it.
AstraZeneca started manufacturing at large scale over the summer, and they've been setting up an international network of multiple manufacturing partners so that the vaccine can be manufactured in many countries around the world.
We have a responsibility to make sure that there's equitable access for everyone in the world.
Governments will be purchasing this vaccine and making it available to the populations of those countries, but also Gavi, the Global Alliance for Vaccines and Immunisation, will be supplied with vaccine, and they can make vaccine available to low-income countries.
Importantly, also, it's possible to distribute it to every corner of the world using the normal supply chain for vaccines that are stored at fridge temperatures.
A lot of the background work that's gone into the adenovirus technology is addressing exactly those questions. You know, how do we make it so that it can be delivered to the places that it's most needed? How do we make it so that we can scale it up to be deployable in tens or hundreds of millions of doses? And how do we make it affordable to the people that are going to need to buy it for deployment in those low middle income countries?
So this is a huge collaborative effort with about 250 people here in Oxford. We have 19 trial sites and then also an international collaboration in Brazil and in South Africa.
I have to say that without the team and without the support of the team, we wouldn't be where we are today.
I'm delighted by the results that we've seen today and would really like to thank the teams who've been working really hard over the last months to bring us to the point where we could look at this interim data.